how do I further explore slightly high coronary calcium score, LP little a that's 50% above the top of the reference range, and borderline high LDL particle count?
Hi, I'm Chris Masterjohn, and I have a PhD in nutritional sciences. I am not a medical doctor, and nothing contained in this episode may be construed as medical or nutritional advice of any kind, or a substitute, therefore. This episode is meant purely as scientific education. If you wish to act on any ideas presented in this episode, please consult your physician first, and never take anything herein as a reason to contradict medical advice. With that said, enjoy the episode.
Danny M. says, hi, Chris. What test biomarkers would you recommend exploring for someone who shows evidence of atherosclerosis per numerically low double-digit CT score that is considered elevated for age range and is slightly increasing over a two-year period compared with borderline high LDL particle count, moderate LP little a that is 50% higher than the top of the standard upper limit, and very low high sensitivity C-reactive protein and fibrinogen? Okay. So there's some moderate calcification going on, and there's slightly elevated LDL-P and LP little a, but low inflammation. Okay. So my interpretation of this is, look, lipid oxidation can be driven by high blood lipids, and it can be driven by inflammation, and it can be driven by a deficiency of factors that protect against calcification. But we know that your inflammation looks good, and so while I wouldn't rule out that maybe you should look at MPO and or lipoprotein associated phospholipase A2 and things like that, just as a check on to make sure that there's not localized vascular inflammation, I think it's reasonable to assume for the sake of discussion that your inflammation levels are low. And so you may have independent factors that are compromising your defense against oxidative stress or compromising your defense against calcification. And we shouldn't rule those out because we don't have data ruling them out like we do for inflammation. But at the same time, it's not necessary to invoke them, because your calcium score is proportionate to your borderline high LDLP, and your LP little a is sort of also proportionate. And so they're not exactly proportionate, but I guess, if you don't have genetics favoring the LP little a repeat, which I don't know if you know that, but let's just assume that it's not genetic, in which case there's not really anything you can do about it. The LP little a is probably an index of oxidized LDL. It might be a better index of LDL oxidation than even an oxidized LDL test. And so given that the LDLP, well, I would look at the LDL. I mean, is the LDLP in line with the LDLC and other more conventional markers? Just assuming it is, then basically you could say that putative LDL oxidation is proceeding at a slightly greater rate than you would expect from your LDLP. And so you could invoke that there is probably something moderate synergizing with the high LDLP to drive the somewhat proportionally higher LP little a. Danny clarifies LDLP is concordant with LDLC and ApoB. Okay. Well, LDLP has to be concordant with ApoB because there's one ApoB protein per LDL particle. And so there would be deep problems to try to figure out if those two weren't concordant. But the fact that the LDL-C is concordant is very useful to know. It's expected, but it's useful to know. So like basically your LDL is high. Doesn't matter if it's LDL-C or LDL-P or ApoB. But it's borderline high, whereas LP little a is 50% above the top of the reference range. And so you could say the LP little a is probably partly driven by the borderline high LDL-P / LDL-C, et cetera. But there might be one or more additional risk factors that are driving up the LP little a, which we could take as a putative marker of LDL oxidation. But those also must be moderate, right? Because it's not like your LP little a is through the roof. It's just a little bit higher than the top of the reference range. And so the CT score is considered elevated for your age range and is slightly increasing over a two-year period. And so I don't know where that is compared to the mean for your age or median for your age, but the way you wrote it up makes it sound like that also is slightly high. And so if that also is slightly high, then my interpretation would be whatever's causing your LDL to be high is probably, if you could get that into the normal range or away from the borderline edge of the top, then there's probably still something related to oxidative stress but I can't rule out that there's not anything related to calcification, but it's like there's not really any need to invoke it. So I guess the thing that has the most evidence here is the LDL-P being high. And so whatever you can, we've already talked in the past about how to reduce that, so I don't think we need to go down that route here. But whatever you can do to get the LDL-P into the more mid-normal, is probably going to be the top thing that would have the most reliable impact on the others. Beyond that, I think the next set of things that would have a reliable impact would be correcting anything related to oxidative stress that you have not corrected. And so I would consult the oxidative stress section of testing nutritional status, the ultimate cheat sheet, for the list of things to look at. And it would be helpful to get oxidative stress related markers such as lipid peroxides or 8-hydroxy-2-deoxyguanosine or MPO or F2 isoprostanes would all be examples of oxidative stress related markers that could tell you just the question, do you have oxidative stress going on beyond what we would expect? And then if you are not able to do any of those markers, or you confirm that yes, you have some oxidative stress going on, then the top things you want to look at are selenium, vitamin E, vitamin C, manganese, zinc, copper, iron, and anything related to glutathione, which would be protein, magnesium, anything that could impact ATP, carbs, insulin, glycine, whey protein, polyphenols. And then secondary to that, if you have some evidence of oxidative stress and none of those line up as things that can explain it, then I would also back up a step and look at energy metabolism. And so that's looking at thyroid health, adrenal health, anything else that might impact ATP. And for vitamins and minerals, especially all the B vitamins with particular emphasis on B1, B2, B3, B5, and then also moderate emphasis on B6 and B7 and somewhat lower emphasis on folate and B12, iron, copper, and sulfur, and magnesium. And then I guess the next tier of things that I think have the least evidence here would be things that can impact calcification directly. And so the top things to look at there are balancing between vitamin D and vitamin A, and then vitamin K2 and magnesium as well as organic acids such as citrate, which you can get from citrate-based supplements, and from any foods that are high in potassium will also be high in citrate, generally speaking. So that's a whole lot of stuff. And I would go through it along the lines outlined in testing nutritional status, the ultimate cheat sheet. So if you can afford it, do comprehensive nutritional testing for all of those things I mentioned. But otherwise, go through the list and see what best matches a dietary analysis. You know, what are the weakest links in your diet? And if you can find other signs and symptoms in the sign and symptom index of the cheat sheet and correlate them, you know, what are those pointing to as, out of the list I just mentioned, the things that need work? And if you forget the list, just consult the oxidative stress section of the cheat sheet and the energy metabolism section of the cheat sheet. And then the calcium metabolism of the cheat sheet. Actually, I think that might be all the major sections of the cheat sheet. But anyway, I hope that helped, Danny. Thank you for your question.
This episode was part of a Q&A for members of the CMJ MasterPass, where I hold monthly private Zoom Q&As for my members. The MasterPass also serves as a buyer's club with exclusive and massive discounts on your favorite premium foods and health products, including pasture-raised and wild meat and seafood, supplements, sleep accessories, water filters, phototherapy devices, and much more. If you'd like to participate in these Q&As, you can join the MasterPass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code Q&A, spelled Q-A-N-D-A, Q&A, for 10% lifetime discount. I am currently working full-time on finishing my first book, Vitamins and Minerals 101, How to Get the Nutrients You Need on Any Diet. I will let you know when I have a release date. In the meantime, you can pre-order the book at chrismasterjohnphd.com/book. Testing Nutritional Status, the Ultimate Cheat Sheet, has been newly released as version 1.3. This is my comprehensive system for managing nutritional status with lab tests, dietary analysis, and comprehensive intake of your signs and symptoms. The new version has a comprehensive guide to interpreting the Genova methylation panel. You can pick up your copy at chrismasterjohnphd.com/cheat sheet. In my consulting, I am neither a medical practitioner nor a coach. I serve as your data analyst and your strategist. I teach you scientific principles of health and wellness, help you analyze your data, and help brainstorm actionable strategies. You can sign up for a consultation at chrismasterjohnphd.com/consultations. Please consider supporting my work at no extra cost to you by visiting my support page and making a purchase with one of my affiliate links. Some of my most popular affiliates are also listed in the description of this video with links that will give me credit for your purchase. I will try to respond to comments when I can, but my presence will be intermittent while I'm finishing my book. I hope you enjoyed this, and I will see you in the next episode.